into full vacation season. We got some good weather, a lot of people traveling. We have some that have traveled, some that are traveling, some that will travel. We have a bunch of teenagers and young people taking off this afternoon. I think our teenagers are headed up, at least several of them, to York College for Soul Quest, and some of the younger kids are headed out to Camp Tallgrass for a few days. So let's keep them in our prayers that they'll travel safely, have a fun week, and also have their faith strengthened at the same time. Why is the Bible such a thick book? In Matthew 22, a Pharisee asked Jesus, "What is the great commandment of the law?" Jesus answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind." And then he added that the second greatest commandment was to love your neighbor as yourself. So we might conclude that boiled down to the most essential elements, the gospel is summed up by the need to love God and to love one's neighbor. If that's the case, why do we need all of this other information? As long as we love God and love each other, why all the other doctrines? Why not keep the message simple? All we have to do is love God and love each other. Isn't the rest optional? The reason that the Bible is longer than just a couple verses about love is that we need to know God's definition of love. Left to ourselves, we wouldn't understand God's love, and we wouldn't know how to love Him or to love each other. As an example, were it not for the Bible, we would not include a crucifixion in our description of love. The crucifixion itself wouldn't fit our concept of love, nor would we see a need for a crucifixion. I mention this because in the minds of many people, a gospel of love and the idea of a loving God would leave no room for a 2 Peter chapter 3. At one time or another, we have all heard someone say that a loving God would not condemn anyone to hell. The whole concept of eternal punishment in their minds is incompatible with a loving God. A loving God is a nice, gentle, cuddly, cosmic grandpa. This God would never send anyone to hell except maybe a very few horribly evil people. We don't know exactly why some false teachers in the first century were denying that Jesus would return and that when he did, there would be a real judgment with some people being saved and others being condemned. We don't know if it had to do with a misguided understanding of divine love or if it was something else. In some cases, it may have been linked to a general denial of a spiritual realm that goes beyond the physical realm. But whatever the reason, they were denying that Jesus is coming back and saying that there would not be a judgment or punishment at that time. It could be thought that the message of 2 Peter chapter 3 is not a loving message, because the message is there will be judgment and there will be punishment. Peter doesn't use the word love in chapter 3 of his second letter. He does, however, use a word that has love as its root. In fact, five times in the chapter, he refers to Christians as beloved. The NIV uses the word friends, which obscures the idea that they were more than friends. They were people whom Peter loved. Peter is writing the message of this chapter to these people because he loved them and because God loves them. We've all heard of the recent court case involving the affluenza teen This is a teenager whose mother supposedly loved him so much that she never taught him that actions have consequences. So he learned that he could do destructive and irresponsible things on the assumption that he would not be held accountable. That description of love isn't biblical. Because God loves us, He holds us accountable. Because Peter loves these people, he is writing this particular message to them. He's writing to tell them that they will be held accountable for the way they live here on earth. That's how he opens the chapter. Verses 1 and 2, "Beloved, I now write to you this second epistle, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior." He was reminding them and warning them because someone else was teaching them a doctrine that was not true. That false doctrine was that there is no final judgment for us to fear. They could live according to their own desires, and it would be okay. The subject of this chapter also brings us into close proximity to several opportunities to chase rabbits, as we sometimes say. We have a lot of curiosity about judgment, about heaven, hell, the afterlife, what it will all be like. Peter does not attempt to answer those questions in this discussion. So this morning, we are not going to try to answer those questions either. We're going to try to see what Peter is writing, the message that he presents in this passage. In a separate lesson, Lord willing, possibly as early as next Sunday, we'll explore some of these other related issues and questions. Chapter 3 is the purpose of 2 Peter. The first two chapters are pretty much preliminaries. They're important, but they're preliminaries. The first part of chapter 1, he stays on a more positive tone. He reminds them of the blessings that they, as Christians, had received from God. And he called them to live holy lives and to grow in holiness as a proper response to those blessings. When he says in chapter 1, verse 9, that their sins had been forgiven, he at least introduces that negative element that there is sin present in this world. The second part of chapter 1 is an affirmation of the validity and the dependability of his message. Peter's readers knew him. They trusted him. He was one of the most credible and reliable witnesses to the teachings and the work of Jesus that they would ever find. And that reminder would be extremely important when Peter would be absent and someone else came along saying that they could go ahead and do things that Peter called sin and there would be no price to pay. Chapter 2 is focused on the reality that there are false teachers in the world. In the Old Testament, people heard conflicting messages. They heard truth. They also heard things that were not true. They had to decide which ones they would follow. And that decision had consequences. People who made the wrong decisions and followed the wrong teachings suffered the consequences. All of that is leading up to the dangerous nature of the false teachings that people were presenting about final judgment. The false doctrine that Peter was warning about is presented and refuted in chapter 3. He continues in verses 3 and 4, "Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lust, and saying, 'Where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation.'" The idea that man can disobey God and not be punished for it is as old as sin itself. I don't know if we could even find a sin where that idea is not present, at least to some degree. Anytime we sin knowingly, somewhere in our thinking, there's this little idea that this is a sin that God won't punish. When Satan tempted Eve, that was basically the idea that he put into her head. You can eat that fruit, and God won't do anything about it. The same thing happened in the days of Noah. People were sinning to their heart's content, and Noah was building an ark to save them. But when he had completed the ark, they decided they didn't need to be saved. They were sinning. They were enjoying it. So why should they think that God's tolerance would ever end if, in fact, there were a God? Peter warns that there will be people in New Testament times as well who will take the same approach and teach the same things. This world has been around a long time, we're told. We're even told that it has actually been around for millions of years, and things just keep on going as they have always gone, just like people said in the days of Noah. So Peter points back to two major historical events that people prefer to deny or forget. Verses 5 and 6, "For this they willfully forget, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water, by which the world that then existed perished, being flooded with water." And this is one of those places where we have an example of the unity of Scripture. In verse 5, he refers to creation. In verse 6, he refers to the flood in the days of Noah. Peter affirms that both of these events really happened, and that they happened by the Word of God. In verse 7, he states that the same Word of God still has control over the destiny of this created world. But the heavens and the earth, which are now preserved by the same Word, are reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. He's saying that the world will continue as it is for as long as God wants, and it will be brought to a screeching halt also when God wants. Peter's point is simple. God made it, and God can and will destroy it when he sees fit. It's no accident that the denial of these historical events produces a disregard for the prophesied event. It doesn't matter really how you get there. It doesn't matter if one denies that there is a God, or if one merely asserts that God didn't do what the Bible says he did the way he did it. The Bible presents one unified, consistent message. If we don't believe in creation by the Word of God, there's no reason to be concerned about judgment by the Word of God. Or we can work it in the opposite direction. If we deny the idea of judgment, maybe because we just don't like it, then there is no reason to believe what the Bible says about creation, or about the redemptive power of the cross to remove something called sin. The heavens and the earth were created by God. They are maintained by God. And they will be destroyed by God when he judges ungodly men. That is Peter's message. Peter wrote this letter so that Christians would not fall victim to the teaching that God's judgment would never happen. Peter then deals briefly with doubts that grew from an unexpected return of Christ, an unexpected delay in his return. Verses 8 and 9. "But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." If there is a statement in the Bible that is more necessary today than it was in the first century, this might be it. I've said in earlier lessons that this letter was probably written in the mid to late 60s of the first century. That means that the death, resurrection, and ascension of Christ and the starting of the church had happened over three decades earlier. Christ and the apostles consistently refused to say when the return of Christ would occur. The message was always, be ready all the time. But it's human nature to be a bit impatient. Just like when we expect God to do something for us in response to our prayers, we want Him to respond affirmatively and quickly. We don't like to wait. And when we have to wait, we sometimes begin to doubt. Some Christians had been waiting and expecting for 30 or 35 years when Peter wrote this letter. They had accepted Christ. They had encouraged others to accept Christ because He was coming back to judge the ungodly and to save the righteous. But now many years had gone by and nothing had happened. So it was natural for people to wonder why it was taking so long. The false teachers of 2 Peter were exploiting that so-called delay. Early Christians were impatient after waiting some 30 years or so. Today we've been waiting over 2,000 years. Scoffers then said, why the delay? Implying that the delay meant it would never happen at all. Scoffers today say the same things. So Peter deals with a very pertinent question. What does the delay mean? The preliminary answer is simply to point out that time doesn't mean the same thing to God that it means to us. Peter's statement may be a paraphrase from Psalm 90, verse 4, which says, for 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it has passed. Even if we took this literally, which we should not do, but it would mean that what seems to be 2,000 years to us is really only like 2 days to God. But that's not the point. And many people through the years have missed the point. People, for example, who want to predict the precise or even the approximate time of when Christ will return, try to use this verse as a code breaker. They'll take an idea such as the 6 days of creation and say that the 6 days are predictive of 6,000 years and Christ will return at the end of the seventh day, therefore 7,000 years after creation. All Peter is saying is that it may seem like a long time to us. It's not to God. In fact, rather than the wait representing a problem, it is really an act of grace. God is in no hurry because He wants to give as many people as possible, as much time as possible, to repent and be saved. The delay isn't because God is goofing around. It's not because He ran into unexpected complications. It's certainly not because He is unable to destroy the world. The word perish that Peter uses in verse 9 is from the same root word that John used in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Peter is saying that God has the same motive for waiting before judgment. He doesn't want anyone to perish that doesn't have to. So He sent His Son, and He gives a maximum time for everyone to repent. So Peter has now lined up several key points to prepare for the final emphasis. The things he is saying are reminders of things taught earlier by prophets and apostles. God has given warnings through earlier lesser acts of judgment and punishment. He has exercised great patience to give us the opportunity to accept Christ. But the day of the Lord will come. Peter's main message is clear and simple. Now, there are a lot of things about the return of Christ that are not clear and simple for us. And these are where all those questions and points of curiosity come in. For example, he's going to write about great noises, melting elements, fervent heat, things that dissolve, and so on and so forth. And we want to have a clear description of what each of those terms mean and what's it going to look like. We want to know if it's literal fire. Because if it's literal fire, then where do you get the darkness that other passages talk about? Peter did not write to answer those questions. For Peter's purposes, not one of those questions is even relevant. In most cases, even if we had an answer to all of our questions along those lines, it would not produce the result that Peter wants. Answering curiosity questions seldom produces greater faith. There are several straightforward points that Peter does make clearly. Number one, the day of the Lord, or whatever you want to call it, the return of Christ, final judgment, whatever, the return of Christ is coming. That is certain. Two, no one will know when it is coming because it will come as a thief in the night. Three, no one will miss it when it happens. There will be too much noise or heat or whatever that represents for anyone to miss the event. And four, the world as we know it will come to an end. For all intents and purposes, we probably don't need any more detail than that. In verses 11 through 13, maybe through 14, you can divide it either way you want, Peter makes clear his purpose in giving these reminders and warnings. He does not say that with this reminder, he hopes he has answered all of the questions his readers may have had. His purpose is to get them to reflect on how they were living. He had already described the sinful lifestyles of the false teachers back in chapter 2. He knows that when people deny the reality of judgment, a major deterrent to sin has been removed. So he asked the question, what manner of persons ought you to be? Verse 11, therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? He doesn't leave any room for doubt when he completes the question with what amount to hints in holy conduct and godliness. His whole purpose is to keep people faithful. Because this world will be destroyed, we need to be ready for what comes next. This calls for holy and godly living. The false teachers were living according to their earthly desires and encouraging others to do the same. That meant that when this earth is destroyed, they would lose everything they valued. They would have received all the satisfaction they were going to get. But those who live holy and godly lives will be ready for the new world where righteousness dwells. So verses 11 through 13 are essentially the conclusion to the letter. In a couple of weeks, Lord willing, we'll look at the closing passage from verse 14 to the end of the chapter. But the main message is complete as of verse 13. As a concluding statement, these three verses bring symmetry to the letter. Here he calls for holy conduct and godliness as we look forward to new heavens and a new earth where righteousness rules. Back in chapter 1, he had called his readers to be diligent to make their salvation certain. Chapter 1, verses 10 and 11, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure, for if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. when this old sin-contaminated world is destroyed, we want to enter the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. False teachings would produce ungodliness and destruction. Believing in and preparing for the day of the Lord would produce godliness and an eternal home in heaven. As I mentioned in an earlier lesson, we don't know for sure that 1 Peter and 2 Peter were addressed to the same original readers, but the themes are certainly compatible. In 1 Peter, the theme is that on earth we are temporary residents. In 2 Peter, the theme is that we should live on earth as people who are preparing for the day when this temporary dwelling will be removed. The specific analogies may be unique to 1 and 2 Peter, but the message is the same throughout the Bible. Everything God did that is recorded in the Bible and the writing of the Bible itself had this same goal. God wants to save us from eternal judgment. He sent His Son to die for our sins. He calls us to believe in His Son, to turn from sin, to be baptized for the forgiveness of our sins. He doesn't want us to perish. If you need to respond to that invitation this morning, don't put it off. If you have not been living the godly life that God's saved people are expected to live, and you want to change that and want the help of the church as you do so, let us know. Let's stand and let's sing.